I've been playing Symphony of War, the Nephilim Saga, because you have no time to game. So I'm going to come clean before going into this. I adore this game, so I may be a little bit biased in my opinions going forward. I've never been a big fan of the indie RPG scene. I've tried a few, and they always felt to me like, as harsh as this is going to sound, cheap knockoffs. They seem to lack their own originality, especially the ones inspired by our Japanese contemporaries. And even more so for the SRPG genre, they all felt like Fire Emblem or Final Fantasy Tactics, but just not as good as those. And on top of that, they tended to not look as good as well. And some of these games are like 20 years old, like 20 years their senior. And so, while looks aren't everything, if your gameplay isn't going to be as good, at least try with your visuals. But anyway, this leads me on to Symphony of War, a game that at first glance looked like it's going to be one of those games again. But the more I looked into it, the more intrigued I became, and eventually I took the plunge, and what a wild ride this has been. This game has single-handedly caused me to look at the indie RPG scene in a different light. So if you have any personal favourites, please put them in the comments so I can have a look. Before going deeper in, let's have a quick look at the basic facts. It was released on June the 10th, 2022, developed by Dancing Dragon Games, published by Freedom Games on PC, and it took me roughly 30 hours to complete on my first playthrough on normal. Tanra is a world on the brink. The major empire of Viridia, the world's superpower, is strife with internal conflict, rebel forces, conspiring politicians, all wrapped up in a prophecy of a dark god rising. We find ourselves in the role of a blue-haired protagonist, male or female. I chose Devoa, the male protagonist. Name and gender really don't matter, though. Devoa was an orphan that, through sheer force of will and dedication, has become a young military commander with his friend Zelos, and they embark on a journey to suppress a rebellion. But things very quickly get out of hand. And, well, they just keep getting more and more out of hand. Until the very gods themselves are involved. And that's... It's not the most complex plot in the world, but it's solid. But how does it play? Well, here we go. This is a strategy RPG, and one that, unlike many others, I can't go it's like X game or X game, because it's kind of its own thing. It has obvious influences from the games. The maps have a very old Fire Emblem field. The army building is kind of reminiscent of Ogre Battles, not Tactics. Like Ogre Battle 64 and such. And we have some job classes that are kind of like somewhere in between Final Fantasy Tactics and Fire Emblem. But yeah, it's kind of taken bits from all of those and made its own thing. Which is good. That's what we want from the indie games. Firstly, the battles are played out on large maps, mostly. It's kind of like a world map view that you see, like I said previously, the older Fire Emblems or Shining Forces. As opposed to the closed-in areas that you have in a lot of tactics games. But there are also, saying that, there are a couple of maps inside buildings which are more closed-in. So it's got variety in the map design. And speaking of variety, there's also variety in the mission design. And for this style of game, I'm so used to them just being a kill-them-all mentality. But here, even disregarding the multitude of side objectives you have for each missions, we have... clear maps, take key points, flee a prison, hold out for as long as you can, and more. This is how a strategy game keeps itself from being stale, and this is one of the big things they've done right in the game, having such variety in mission structure, and it not just being kill all the enemies every time. The battles themselves revolve around an I-go-you-go model, as in I move all my units, the enemy moves all of their units. As opposed to, say, Shining Forces, speed-based battle order. Movement limits are defined by the type of unit your squad is. So this could be heavy infantry up through to cavalry to flying types. The movement is defined by what the majority of the squad actually is. So an example being, if I have 3 horse bros and 2 walking bros, then I'm a horse bro squad, so I'm a cavalry squad. Attacking is a simple affair as long as you're in range of the enemy. You can hit them. In most of the cases, you basically have to be touching because it's melee weapons, but we have archers and gunners and all that sort of stuff as well with different ranges. The battles between the squads then play out. they attack, you get counterattacked as well. Meaning you need to be careful, as the counterattack can badly hurt you if you're not prepared. Also, after a certain point in the game, we get magical abilities. These give you various buffs or extra movement options. These magical abilities can really make a difference if used correctly as well. The last little bit, when we're talking about battles, is the objectives. Basically, as the maps are quite big, there's a bunch of objective points on the map. And these all have different things. So you've got mines to temples for resurrecting your units. And they all give you slightly different things for capturing them. There's also an extra little bit of fun, in addition to all of this, in the form of capturing enemy units. And this is very much worth doing when you're playing the game. It took me a little bit of time to get my head around it, but you have the option, instead of just attacking, to capture the enemy. And if you're lucky, with some ways to increase your luck to almost certain, the enemy squad in question will just give up. But this is only usually after like beating the daylights out of them, and there's only like one or two left in their squad. But you can force large groups to give up as well, but you tend to suffer an attack first, and you need to be strong enough to then kind of kill the units back in one hit, because you don't get any extra attacks. Normal attacks can play out, you hit, the enemy hits you, you hit them again, the enemy hits you again. But capturing, they hit you, you hit them, and done. So you need to be able to kill them to capture them. This is all really worth doing, because when you capture enemies, you get extra points for your army building mechanics. So this gives you points towards leveling up your faction, which in turn gives you points to spend on the tech tree. And spending points on the tech tree is something you really want to do and complete as early as possible in the game, because the tech tree gives you buffs, new units, and upgrades and more. Now, we need to build our squads as well. This can be somewhat of a lengthy process in between each mission, but it's very versatile. First, you have a leader. In most cases, this will be a story-relevant character. But you can also buy and raise units from a merchant. Each unit has a leadership value that defines how many units you have in a squad. Higher leadership, more units, up to a maximum 9 in each squad, with some types taking up more than one spot, so then you'll have less. It's like a dragon takes up 2 spots. Each individual unit has its own class upgrade path, with its promotion choices defined by its stats and level, etc., that you get them. So you'll need certain stats to be able to upgrade into one type of unit, and you'll need a different type of stat layout to upgrade into a different path for the unit. And various things can influence how a character grows, meaning they might be more suitable to go down one path than another. So there's a lot of flexibility in this, so we can do things like make a spear-based horse squad, cannons with shield guards, dragons, and more. So there's a lot of choice and flexibility in how you build your squads. And while the menus are somewhat clunky, it is fun to play around with all the options to see what you can create. And on top of all of this, the developers are still working on patches for extra modes and are working on feedback they get from the user base as well. So changing things and updating things as it goes. And they said they're working on a second game. So, but what is actually good about the game? The game does so much right, from its quite unique and well-designed and fun battle system to the surprisingly good tale it weaves. But most of all, it's the variety. As I previously mentioned, we have a ton of mission objectives, maps, unit types, meaning you can really play how you want. Like, mine was kind of a generic run through because I played through it once, but I've seen people doing like a Mongol run where every unit is on a horse and things like that. Like, it's so much variety in what you can do. Like, you can probably play it how you want and still succeed as well. Like, that's quite important. A lot of games have variety, but kind of force you down one path. This game doesn't. You can tend to succeed within the variety itself. And as a bonus, it took me 30 hours and I was left wanting more, as opposed to wanting it to end, which is something I feel about a lot of games when I get towards the end. I just want them to end. But this one, actually, I was like, oh, it's ending. Oh, never mind. So what about the negative? There's only really one element I want to bring into focus, and that's the army management. Like I said, it takes a bit of time, it's a lengthy process, and the UI, like the user interface itself, is quite clunky as well. But it didn't really like hinder my enjoyment that much. It just meant things took a bit longer than they possibly could have. A bit more streamlining, a bit more rethinking about how that those menus are laid out and how they're used, and it would work really well. Like, not that it doesn't work, it just could do with a tweak. But anyway, it's, other than just me, what have the others been saying about it? Well, from the gaming critics' point of view, the game's done quite well, getting an 81 overall on both its critic score and user score on Metacritic. I don't think I've ever seen before getting the exact same. One of the first reviewers I looked at was RPG Fan, and they concluded, "I was pleasantly surprised with the time I spent playing this SRPG. In many ways, it draws from classic heavyweights of the genre, but it also has more than enough substance to stand on its own. There's certainly a lot to uncover and do throughout a playthrough, and it also has a moderate replay value given the ways players' choice alters certain narrative events. Symphony of War, the Netflix saga, is an adventure fans of tactical RPGs might want to keep an eye on." Yeah, it's pretty much similar to a lot of things I've said already. With PC Gamer going on to say, "Novel tactical mechanics make this indie a contender for the best strategy RPG of this year." So yeah, they both had quite a positive spin on the game overall, aligning in a lot of cases with my own views. But I must say, it's not just a contender for SRPG of the year. As of September, when I'm recording this, it firmly holds that position in my eyes, and it'll take one hell of a game to knock it off. But yeah, as you probably guessed, my own personal feelings, I absolutely adore this game. It was great. It isn't just a clone of something else, and it does so much right. This is what I want to see from the indie scene. Like, making things that are truly their own. Truly, that are, when I think of indie, like the indie games and stuff, I always think of different to the normal, not just another cookie cutter that's been made before. And that's what this game has gone and done. It's taken the base of things that come before it and expanded and become its own thing. And on top of all of this, if you're the sort of person that uses Discord, their community is actually really nice and really helpful. And it's, if you start to play the game and enjoy it, join it, get advice, talk to the developers. Everyone's really responsive. It's great. But yeah, so my overall rating is must play.